In the last video, we looked at bond dissociation energy as a measure of covalent bond strength, and in this video, we're going to focus on quantifying the strengths of ionic bonds using the concept of lattice energy. Lattice energy is defined as the energy required to separate one mole of a solid ionic lattice into the gaseous ions. So we're taking a solid ionic salt, for example, sodium chloride or lithium nitrate, and separating those ions in the gas phase to create M plus and X minus ions. This is associated with some enthalpy change. That enthalpy change is the lattice energy, and this is universally endothermic. We are breaking very, very strong ionic bonds. And so lattice energies tend to be very high and are universally positive. What we'd like to be able to do is roughly predict the relative lattice energies of two or more ionic compounds. And we can do this using the idea that lattice energy is roughly governed by Coulomb's law. So Coulomb's law reflects the force of attraction between charged particles. And that's what's happening inside an ionic bond. There's electrostatic attraction between the cations and the anions. And so roughly speaking, lattice energy is correlated with the energy of electrostatic attraction associated with Coulomb's law. So we can say roughly that delta H lattice energy is proportional to the products of the charges of the ions involved in the compound. So Z plus, Z minus are these ionic charges in the ions, divided by the distance between them. That's what's meant by this R0 value. By thinking through this equation, we can see how structural factors affect lattice energy. Greater lattice energy is associated with two structural factors. First of all, greater charges, or Qs, or Zs, of the ions. Plus 2 and minus 2 ions have a stronger lattice energy than plus 1 and minus 1 ions, other things being equal. The second important structural factor is this R0, the distance between the centers of the ions. Because that appears in the denominator in this expression on the right-hand side, smaller R0, smaller ions are associated with a greater lattice energy. In essence, this puts the charged particles closer to one another, makes the force of electrostatic attraction greater, so on and so forth. So for example, let's consider the series of four ionic compounds shown here. In order to rationalize this trend in lattice energy with MgO as the highest and lithium fluoride as the lowest, LIF, let's look at the charges and the relative sizes of the ions. So first, the charges. In MgO, we've got an Mg2 plus cation and an O2 minus anion. In MgF2, we have again the Mg2 plus cation with an F1 minus anion. MgI2 likewise has that Mg2 plus cation and I minus anion. And lithium fluoride has a lithium plus cation and an F minus anion. So we can see that from left to right, roughly speaking, the charges are decreasing in magnitude, with plus 2, minus 2 being associated with the greatest, the most endothermic, we might say, lattice energy, and plus 1, minus 1 being associated with the smallest or the least endothermic lattice energy. Now, MgF2 and MgI2 have matching charges, so how do we rationalize this difference in lattice energy? Well, to understand this difference, we have to look at fluoride versus iodide and appreciate that fluoride is a significantly smaller ion than iodide. These are both group 17 elements. They're both halide anions. Iodide is further down on the periodic table, and so it's much larger than fluoride. And this means that the R0 value in MgF2, this distance between the ionic centers, is much smaller than it is in MgI2. And so because that's in the denominator, that R0 value, MgF2 will have the larger or more endothermic lattice energy. So here we're using this second point, the correlation of R0 with lattice energy, to rationalize the difference between MgF2 and MgI2. In this problem, we're asked to compare the lattice energies of Al2O3 and Al2Se3. And let's start, as we did on the last slide, by considering the charges and the sizes of the ions. So first, let's split each of these compounds into their component ions and examine the charges. Here we have Al3 plus and O2 minus. Notice that the overall charge is balanced. We've got plus 6 overall from the two aluminums and minus 6 overall from the three oxygens. And in fact, if we think through Al2Se3, we'll realize that we have the exact same ionic charges in this compound as well, plus 3 on the aluminums and minus 2 on the selenide anions. So to appreciate the difference between these, we need to think about the radii and the ionic sizes. Selenium and oxygen are both in group 16. Selenium is further down on the periodic table, so it is larger than oxygen, even as a minus 2 anion. And this means that the greater lattice energy associated with the smaller anion is associated with Al2O3. So larger, more endothermic lattice energy is associated with the alumina, Al2O3. Lattice energies are so endothermic that they're very difficult and typically impossible to measure directly. However, we can measure lattice energies indirectly by taking advantage of Hess's law and using a set of processes that ultimately adds up to this lattice energy process of taking the solid ionic compound and breaking it up into its gaseous ions and adding up all those enthalpy changes to get the lattice energy. So to see how this works, and this general process, by the way, is known as a Born-Haber cycle, going from the solid ionic compound up to the ions and then back down again. This is known as a Born-Haber cycle. To see how this works, let's consider the question of determining the lattice energy of solid cesium fluoride, or CSF. That is the negative of this exothermic enthalpy associated with going from the gaseous ions back down to the solid ionic lattice, which we might call deposition. And that overall process we can think of as involving going around the cycle, like so. So for example, we can start with solid cesium fluoride, apply decomposition to get it back to elemental cesium and half a mole of elemental fluorine. We can sublime the cesium solid to get it in the gas phase, convert the solid to a gas. And then we can ionize that cesium to form cesium cation. We know the energy associated with that. That's the ionization energy of cesium. We can then break up the fluorine molecules into individual fluorine atoms. That's bond cleavage, half the dissociation energy, half the bond dissociation energy for F2, where the one half comes from the half a mole we're dealing with here. And then we can give an electron to the F atom, and that is electron capture associated with the electron affinity of fluorine. Now we have cesium plus and F minus ions in the gas phase, and this is the end point for the lattice energy process, right? We've gone all the way from cesium fluoride solid to the gaseous ions, not directly by ripping those ions apart from one another, but by taking a set of steps, each of whose enthalpies we know. So those enthalpies are listed on this slide. And on the next slide, to determine the lattice energy, all we do is take those individual enthalpy values for the steps and add them together, as we would in a Hess's law sort of problem, right? We've got a process that goes from point A to point B via a series of steps. We can add up those steps and add up their enthalpies to determine the enthalpy of the overall process. And in doing so, we arrive at a lattice energy of 756.9 kilojoules per mole for cesium fluoride.